Welcome to Code Squirrel. My name is Michael Dwyer. Even after 20 years of software development, I still can't get enough of learning and using new technologies. If I'm able to help you learn something, that would be awesome. So please let me know if you do learn something. Heck, even if you think that I'm wrong, I'm dumb, I'm stupid, I don't care. Let me know. It's fun to know you're out there. Today, we're going to talk about PowerShell. And guys, PowerShell is one of my favorites. It is ridiculously awesome. Super powerful, hence the name. So let's dig in.
Starting with the basics and trying to be precise, what is PowerShell? It's a command line shell tied to a scripting language. And what is it especially good at? Task automation and configuration management is what it's best at. But as tends to be the case with a lot of technologies like this, it can do just about anything. And you might be thinking, sounds a lot like CMD, Bash, and a bunch of other similar command line shells. And those also have associated scripting languages. So what's the difference here? Well, you're right. It is a lot like those. In fact, it learned a lot from those. But it does have the advantage of being built from the ground up, starting much more recently than those tools. So PowerShell started its earliest infancy was around 2006. So that puts it, about 14 years old at this point. Contrast that to CMD, which is about 32 years old, and Bash, just as another example, which is about 30 years old. So those were developed in around the 80s. And in the 80s, when those shells were created, technology was way different. Not really dumber, just different, right? So it's not like PowerShell, in some ways, I think it's true that PowerShell is just fundamentally better. But mostly, it's just that PowerShell works better for the modern computer systems that we work with. So it's a different set of non-functional requirements and infrastructure. In the 2000s, when PowerShell itself was built, we had the full realization of object-oriented software in .NET, among others. PowerShell is built from the ground up using .NET, and that is one of the coolest aspects of it. But you might ask, how does being in .NET really matter? One should always challenge things like that, of course, but here are some of the keys in this case. So first of all, it's open source. PowerShell is open source, PowerShell Core to be specific. It's pretty recent, but it's also based on .NET, .NET Core specifically, which is itself open source. So PowerShell Core is too. It's also cross-platform in a way that some of the other command lines have attempted to achieve, but not really succeeded at, in my opinion. It is, most of all, I think, just plain powerful. .NET is a very well-established, highly productive coding environment. It's got a vibrant community of over 8 million developers. .NET is a modern, awesome, object-oriented infrastructure. Okay, let's get started with our first PowerShell command. Here I am in PowerShell, and the command is get-help. All right, so the way that you use get help, get command. So get help on the get command. And there you can see I got a bunch of really good help information about the get command. You can see, the parameters that it takes and whether or not they're required or optional, and their data types and stuff like that, as well as an explanation for how it's intended to be used, related articles. You can even, down here you can see, to see the examples, type get help, get command dash examples. And this is really cool because this is a very long list outlining different examples. So if we use these commands, we can really get to any other command, especially since, as you're probably already starting to notice, there's a nice clean pattern to PowerShell commands. One of the things that I love about PowerShell is there's a lot of thought put into the kind of learnability, readability of PowerShell. So once I know get command and I know how to use it, because I can do get help on it, then I can do all sorts of things to look up commands that are out there. So if I just type get command and nothing else, I get this ridiculously long list of commands. These are all the commands that I have loaded on my system. And I've got a lot. And you'll have a lot as well. So oh, it stopped. All right. So now you can also do matching syntax, right? So typical kind of star question mark type syntax with the parameter that you're passing as far as that you can pass, which is a matching criteria for the command. So let's say I want to find all of the commands that reference a list somewhere in the name. So I do star list star. There you go. Those are all the commands that have list in the name. There, you know, of course, one of the best ways also to look up a command or something that you're trying to figure out, if you can't figure out conventionally based on this conventional pattern that you're starting to see with the names, you know, one great place to go is Google. You will find lots of good information on Google about this. So if I want to say, let's say PowerShell command to create a file, new item, right there, bam. So, and if you, you know, get into complex kind of questions about why something's behaving a certain way, you're going to end up most likely at Stack Overflow. And you'll find lots of great information there. So with that, you're probably already empowered as an experienced programmer to really go very far with PowerShell. But I think there's a few other things that are going to really speed up that process of you getting powerful with PowerShell. So the next one is to just kind of go over the pattern of the naming convention. It's probably already becoming pretty clear to you because it's pretty basic. I liken it to the RESTful design pattern in that REST does a great job of kind of taking a conceptual model that is really simple and makes sense to most developers and using it as the centerpiece of the way that the kind of pattern is laid out. In REST, as you know, you typically just use HTTP and you have the HTTP verbs, right? Get, post, put, delete, etc. That same pattern applies here. The beginning of every PowerShell command is a verb and then a dash. So you have get and set and new. You can see them here and update. In this particular case, at least as compared to HTTP-based REST, there are a lot more verbs in PowerShell than you would in REST, but they're actually very well documented. In fact, by Microsoft's documented standards, they're required to be followed. There's a set of them that are conventionally approved by Microsoft. So here we see approved verbs for PowerShell commands. You can find this easily online on Microsoft documentation. And you'll see that it's a very long article, very well documented. It explains the rules. It explains the nuanced difference between the verb new versus the verb set, and you know, on down some other examples. And then here is the long list of approved verbs along with their explanations. Right? So I think that's very powerful. You quickly get used to at least the most common ones like get and set and list and write and output and stuff like that. So the first part is a verb. And the second part is a noun. So the command that we found on Google was new item, right? So it's new dash and then a noun, item. It's a singular noun. And then this command effectively processes for each of those items that it is provided or that it's provided the information to find. That is the pattern. And then you have, so that's the pattern for the command. And then of course you have parameters. And there are a lot of different ways that you can do parameters, but the kind of the most explicit and at least for your scripts that you would write, the best way to do the parameters is to write them out completely as named parameters. And the name of a parameter starts with a dash. It takes a little getting used to, but it does kind of fit the style of everything else. So, you know, let's do get help on new item and see what its parameters are. Okay, so if you see up here, it has path as a parameter, dash path, dash credential, dash force, dash name, dash value, dash confirm, right? So if I want to create a new item, new dash item, we'll do a path of C colon temp, and then we want to put test.txt. For fun, let's do confirm. Some of the parameters don't have a value, they're just flags, like dash confirm, and you can see that they, in the documentation up here, there's, you know, they're just, it's just the parameter name in brackets. So let's do this, and it's giving me the confirmation. Are you sure you want to perform this action? And yes, I do. All right, so it has written that file out here, test.txt. So very basic, but you know, as an experienced programmer, following this conventional model, using Google, using the help that is built in here, you can get very powerful very fast. Now, there's, before we go on to a few other topics, I do wanna, there's one other really important thing that you wouldn't just inherently know that is gonna take it to even yet another level, and it is my favorite part of PowerShell. It is piping.
Woohoo, piping!
You know, something that CMD and Bash and a bunch of others can do, borrowed from kind of the Unix world, very powerful and very well done in PowerShell, especially since every command returns an object in PowerShell, so you can do very powerful things with piping. Piping in PowerShell looks just like it does in those other shells, so you have something like, let's do get child item, which is a way of doing a directory scan. So that's going to look in the C colon right here and give me a bunch of lists of files and such. Now what's really cool is let's do get child item. I think there's a filter. Let's do filter by star.ini for no particular reason. Okay, now let's pipe. So we do a vertical bar, and we're sending the result, the stream of that, the objects coming out of getChildItem into another command. And it's important to understand that it is going to take each of the objects that it finds, and it's going to pipe each of them in a stream one at a time into this next command. So the next command we're going to use is one of my favorites. It's export-csv. How awesome is that? So I can just do, we'll be explicit here since I said that's a good idea. C colon temp slash ini info dot csv. Bam, guys. Wait till you see. There it is. All of the information very nicely formatted into a CSV file. No additional trickery I have to do to get it to look right. It is an object, so it's very able to put it into columns in a CSV. And there you go. Fantastic. So, I mean, there are more things to know about piping, but it tends to be as easy as that. What you would assume the piping behavior to do for a command is usually what it does. And if you need to do more advanced things, you got Google or additional videos that I'll produce here. So you've got power at your fingertips now with PowerShell.
And we're gonna cut it off there, guys. I will do some additional videos, so check for those. And hopefully you learned something. Thanks a lot.